Welcome back to Left of the Dial, taking you through the classic age of vinyl and beyond. And we're going to be trying something a little bit different today. Before anything else, I would like to start the video off by saying disco sucks. Okay, not really, but that's how I want to get the ball rolling. The disco ball rolling. Saying disco sucks is how I want the disco ball to be rolling. No matter how far away from it we get, disco sucks will just have to be the prevailing mantra of this video, the big sentiment that everything circles back around to. Because in this world I was born into, disco is always just the worst thing to have ever happened, unanimously accepted as the absolute scourge of all popular music. No question about it, there was absolutely no argument in its favor. It was a terrible fad, never to be repeated, filled with dorky afros, leisure suits, roller rinks, and technicolor vomit as far as the eye can see. Disco had always been discussed only in hushed tones or loud jeers, that's just the way it was. But things are starting to change. These days, many are looking back at this era more kindly, and find that this music has a lot of longevity to it that had gone unfairly dismissed. There is artistic merit to be found in this music that's worth appreciating and replicating. Plus, it took more than long enough for this genre to finally get its fair shake. It's kind of ridiculous, really, that everybody had to act too cool to admit that they could enjoy some of this really catchy music. Pete Townsend of The Who recalls about hearing the ABBA song SOS in a BBC radio interview he did, stating, "I remember hearing SOS on the radio in the States and realizing that it was ABBA, but it was too late because I was already transported by it. I just thought it was such a great sound." He later remarked that it was one of the best pop songs ever written, but he would only give a glowing recommendation to this music years after the fact, just like anybody else. Oh, and a quickie fun fact. SOS by ABBA is the only top 20 song to have both the band and the title be a palindrome. Disco was unique for a lot of reasons. For its music, sure. Its cultural impact, absolutely. But its legacy is most significantly tied to its absolute implosion. One of the most ugly burnouts in music history, a genre fitted with an actual date of death. Other genres stall out over time, or else come to a natural close, but disco is here today and gone tomorrow. It is so rare to have an entire art form die so suddenly and abruptly overnight. These anti-disco tensions ran high before finally culminating to the death of disco center field that fateful, infamous day. Suddenly, everybody stopped wanting more, 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 and began demanding a whole lot less, less, less. This is where the story ends for disco, and the violent release from its inescapable cultural orbit was seen as an absolute win for music fans at large. But I want to know more about the aftermath. Nothing truly dies this fast without any lingering reverberations. I wanted to know if there were any more developments from the seemingly unsalvageable genre of music. Lo and behold, there was a silver lining to the downfall of disco after all, because it gave way to the concept of post-disco. And I want to tell you about it. So strap on your boogie shoes, everybody. When talking about post-disco, the most clear-cut examples of the sound are from the relative newcomers who relate to the party. But there have been a few established acts that have changed their sound into something that fits the post-disco label. I should clarify real fast that I think post-disco only barely meets the qualifications as an actual genre. It's so easy for music historians to throw a suffix like post or proto onto any major genre of music and call it a significant recontextualization, but it doesn't always work out that way. The line is pretty fine. I could see someone listening to any number of these songs and think that it's no different than plain old dance pop from the 80s, no need for a separate genre name. That said, I've been finding myself more and more fascinated with the idea of post-disco as a concept, mostly because I think it makes sense. This video is about the fall of the disco empire, its subsequent evolution into something brand new from its ashes called post-disco, and the long road the genre has traveled to turn its reputation around into something that is a viable form of music making for artists working today. Because I do want to set the precedent that this channel isn't only for rock music. It's a big world of music out there, and it's no fun placing boundaries or restrictions on music listening habits. This style of music isn't ordinarily the first one I'll reach for off the shelf, but I do have a good amount of fondness for it. While disco admittedly wasn't always a kind of music I could get down with, I've since grown a soft spot for the genre, if for no other reason than it being rhythm-based. For my preferred music listening, a good beat goes a long way. Full transparency here, this video topic came about while I was writing the script for my next classic song review, which will be the 1984 song In My House by the Mary Jane Girls. Cause it's a song that has a lot going for it, both musically and historically. since it was a girl group created by self-proclaimed funk punk master Rick James, along with being a fleeting moment of success for a then-struggling Motown Records in the 80s that was also included on the PMRC's Filthy 15 list. But what really got me is that this song is what I consider to be a defining work of post-disco.
Post-disco?
I hope that is as interesting to you as it is to me, because I just had to marvel at the mere idea of post-disco in and of itself, and I was not prepared for the breadth of information and relevancy that this movement has had on music. I knew I would be getting into interesting territory, sure, but to fully understand the scope of post-disco, I had to plumb some deep depths in order to come back with something I could present to the class today. I honestly felt like I had to break out some red yarn in a bulletin board just to connect the dots, but it was very rewarding. Not just because it has an excellent and very unique genre sound, but because of the circumstances that spawned it and how it influenced the course of music history forever. I honestly do not believe that to be an exaggeration. So take notes, kiddos! Anyway, the more and more I was writing for my classic song review, I was starting to wonder if I was getting lost in the weeds a little bit. I didn't want to dilute the video, so I made the topic into its own video instead. All the context is good, great even, but it started to make discussion of the song itself seem almost tangential. So I chose to separate it into two videos. Consider this your two-for-one deal. It's the prelude to the full concerto, if you will. Or like purchasing a double LP from the store. In the next video, you'll see the style of music in action, further explored over the course of a single song. Plus, this double record metaphor counts towards two separate sales for me, the creator. How about that? Before taking the dive into the fascinating world of post-disco, I want to lead the discussion off by acknowledging that right now is the time to be examining the disco phenomenon in full, because it is currently playing into major works as we speak. I'd surmise that the way people remember disco is how we think of hair metal these days. Not least of which is from how it was killed in brutal fashion by another arguably more respectable genre. But things have changed somewhere in the last 5 to 10 years. I've been looking pretty hard at where current music is heading, and I'm telling you right now that disco music is coming back into style, baby! It sounds ridiculous, right? Disco sucks! But music history has a way of repeating itself, just like anything else in the history of the world. If you keep with this channel of mine, you'll learn that I love connecting the dots between music trends, small and large. People are drawn to art for various reasons, and these reasons can be imitated. Music trends are cyclical.
It's like poetry, so if they rhyme.
Well said, George.
Hopefully it'll work.
Like I was saying, disco sound is now beginning to drive forward a lot of pop and R&B music. And I've got theories for it. Oh man, do I have theories. And stranger things have happened, no doubt about it. If 1999 could usher in a full-on swing revival straight out of nowhere, I think it's perfectly reasonable to anticipate a disco resurgence. Even more bizarrely, and hear me out on this one, I think there's a strong argument to make for these modern disco-esque cuts to sound closer in line to what some are calling post-disco than anything else. I want to look at what happened after Americans took "Let's Burn This Disco Down" to its most extreme. This ain't no party, this ain't no disco. It was something else entirely. This is post-disco. Yeah, I am aware that I'm wearing an aggro noise rock band's t-shirt while talking about music that's basically the audio equivalent of candy floss. The irony is not lost on me. But I'm not patting myself on the back for it either, though, because I know that's the exact slippery slope that leads to the picture of the guy wearing a swan shirt at a Carly Rae Jepsen photo op. And nobody wants that. Since this sound is starting to become the current flavor, there have been a number of songs from the era that have enjoyed a staggering second life over the past decade. Off the top of my head, Earth, Wind & Fire September is bigger now than it ever was, even in its prime. In hindsight, it somehow reached that rare legendary status that has turned Africa into a decade-defining track. Even just 10 years ago, your average person wouldn't have considered it to be their signature song. That title more likely would have gone to Boogie Wonderland or Shining Star. But now? Forget it. You're never gonna miss another 21st night of September as long as you live. There are some similar songs whose stock have risen in recent years. Songs like Funky Town, I Will Survive, Staying Alive, Play That Funky Music, Brick House, and lest we forget the disco monster to end it all, Dancing Queen. I don't think these songs were hated or anything until now, but their legacies were all thoroughly kneecapped by being associated with disco, a genre that nobody wanted to mythologize or give proper kudos to. The tides are turning for a number of reasons, and music listeners are being prompted to finally start reevaluating disco music. Not just reevaluate it either, really praise it this time. Its reputation has taken a full 180, and many are claiming it to be one of the great moments of the 70s, and artists are beginning to infuse its successes into their own music. Which is still just baffling to me. But the times, they are a-changin'. I think Post Malone said that. The pendulum has swung in the complete opposite direction, and artists are embracing disco wholeheartedly. Successfully, too. Music with this sound is now able to get serious radio airplay, massive appreciation from the critics, or both simultaneously. And it's usually not something attempted as a cheap throwaway, either. Many of these songs rely on their disco components entirely. It has somehow evolved past a pastiche, and is becoming its own recognizable sound in the modern music landscape, building upward from what disco has set up all those decades ago. The most landmark track off of 2018's Album of the Year, per the Grammys, was a disco-pop hybrid. And that's not to mention 2014's recipient of the award, Random Access Memories, which has the duo's metallic fingerprints spanning all across the genre. The smash success of their lead single, Get Lucky, would have single-handedly catapulted the style of music back into action if it hadn't been held off from the top spot on the charts by Robin Thicke and Pharrell's own interpretation of the same era. Even today's rock listeners can dip a toe in the water when they listen to the ultra-successful The Less I Know The Better from Tame Impala's Currents, a record that many claim as a very notable work of rock music in the 2010s. At this very moment, there's a high-charting song that's pulling straight from the disco tapestry. These new iterations don't carbon copy the formula exactly. It's more of a disco light, perhaps. Diet disco, if you will.
The AIDS diet plan no. really worked.
Delicious tasting AIDS.
That's not what I meant. Diet disco don't mean that.
Why not try AIDS?
I don't think we've officially given this trend a name yet, so I'll chime in favor for those calling it the disco revival. Conversely, I've seen the phrase new disco being thrown around, but I'm not as crazy about it, but to each their own. I'm not here to set big premonitions or place Wall Street-level bets on rising trends in music, but I am pretty confident that this is only going to grow more prevalent as the decade moves onwards, specifically in the first leg of the 2020s. These are just my music predictions. Don't rely on me to pick your lottery numbers.
Although you should totally put all your money on 41, 26, 32, 16, and 22.
There were also a few songs using disco as a retro template in the mid to late 2000s, which helped place it inside of a newer context. A context that could even be relevant to newer music, if you follow. What a concept. Its resurgence in the public eye came about right around the same time that music journalists began fully embracing the poptimist mentality.
I wanna take a ride on your disco stick.
Sure, I guess you could put that in the conversation too, if you feel compelled. Disco music would even be emulated by 2000s dance punk bands, a surely apocryphal music pairing, but man if it sounds awesome. Artists are exploring this genre sound for a variety of reasons. For practical purposes, synth nerds are finding more and more uses for modular synths on their tracks, so it makes sense to start pulling from the disco fabric when pairing against a real-life band. Funky guitars and tight beats are also the stylish sounds for many producers and studio musicians, since they're all the rage with the virtuoso jazz fusion types. These perky, effervescent songs also stand out amongst the crowd when we look at what music was the most popular over this past decade. Because a lot of this past decade was pretty down in the dumps, and you better believe it tampered with popular music. Most everything from the 2010s decade was low register, perpetually frowny, and intentionally hollow in nature, just almost always in a bad mood. This is the decade of sad boy culture manifesting all over our music. For God's sake, the name of one of the biggest hit songs from 2017 was literally the Suicide Prevention Hotline's phone number. If that doesn't say it all, then I don't know what will. I can only imagine how music historians are gonna look back at this era of music in relation to major events of the time. The melancholic auto-tune crooning of 808s and Heartbreaks obviously looms large over this era in music. Sometimes these songs feel like they barely even exist at all, just floating around as a formless mush for depressed listeners to vaguely glower at. But these things tire themselves out eventually, and I think we're beginning to see a light at the end of the tunnel here. This particular phase of our collective music listening habits is not without precedent either. When looking for a similarly widespread generational angst in music and popular culture, the closest point of comparison would probably be the 90s, in my humble opinion. 2010's music was probably the most dour that popular music had been since the 90s, and I don't think that these levels of darkness was ever as in-step to the times as they were in these two decades. To be totally thorough, though, there was a brief blip in the 60s when the somewhat overdramatic but still socially stirring folk music was the sound to be reckoned with. But all the doom and gloom never fully reached ahead and was eventually washed away by the Summer of Love's subsequent sanitization, which kind of made it irrelevant and wiped the slate clean, replacing protest songs and the such with miles of smiles instead. Even today, the grunge boom is still mostly seen as sincere and full of authenticity, and it makes sense why it was such a breath of fresh air at the time. New Kids on the Block had a bunch of hits, but these songs made alt-rockers sick. 1991 was the year alternative broke, and nothing was the same. We all know what the moods, themes, and general feel of grunge music are. It is clearly not designed to be consumed as feel-good music, and yet it was something that an entire generation could connect with. Strange, isn't it? There is this underlying curiosity about its popularity when you take into account that the 90s were a pretty non-turbulent time for Americans. The economy was thriving, the nation wasn't at war, President Clinton had high approval ratings. There really wasn't all that much need for such a depressive music to sweep the country like it did then. Even when looking at popular films of the time, many were filled with civil disrest, white-collar boredoms and frustrations. I do think there are plenty legitimate reasons for this current wave of sadness to be at the forefront of our culture right now, but people have noticed a change in direction recently. Happier and more energetic songs are getting support, and these mood boosters are coming from young singers, teenagers even. Positivity is a good look in tough times. If I may quote from one of the best punk albums of the past couple years, many are using joy as an act of resistance. And the same thing happened in the 90s. Music can only be sad and gloomy for so long before it starts to run itself into the ground and people begin craving uplifting songs instead. 1994 is the year set on the books when grunge ended, but that didn't mean that something immediately came along to replace the style. So the music at large was in this gray area where everybody was still upset and angsty, but nobody really seemed to know why anymore, I don't think. But shockingly enough for the time, there were a few smash successes that stood in direct opposition to the grunge era. Swedish songwriter and producer Dennis Pop was among the first to edge in among the brash, unapologetic aesthetic of grunge and gangster rap music that was both getting actual quantifiable radio play at the time. Both these genres were most likely to have been seen as much too dark and alienating to become the cultural sensations they were before the SoundScan era of data collection leveled the playing field. Dennis Pop was the mastermind behind Ace of Base's The Sign, which ended up the number one song of the entire year of 1994 and showed that brighter songs could be a viable cell shade for radio rotation that people would buy. And for the record, I always mentally slotted that song way later in the decade. I didn't realize it was early as 94. Another turn towards lighter music was this one. Love Fool by the Cardigans had ultra-sugary melodies and a weird lounge music slant, all while retaining an ironic edge that teens couldn't get enough of at the time. It also featured some left-field bossa nova chords, which also helped it to stand out. It might not seem like it now, but it was a massive sea change for the time. Take note that both of these songs were of Swedish origin, and the full sunshinification of pop music would be complete by 1998 when the Swede Max Martin kickstarted the age of teen pop. Sound familiar? Things were looking up for a change, and these songs were just a harbinger of things to come. Critics and music historians, when looking back at the 90s, point to grunge and hardcore rap first, but there's a whole lot of people who remember this decade for TRL and the boy band wars, first and foremost. The second half of the 90s was at direct odds with the first half. Oh, and contemporary country was just absolutely massive at the time. I really shouldn't forget to include that. I have seen countless wholehearted and unironic writings on how I Want It That Way is actually one of the greatest pop songs in music history. Obviously owing more to the genius of Max Martin than the featured artists themselves. And I don't know how a lot of this stuff has aged, quite honestly. People still reminisce on taking a devoted stance either with NSYNC or the Backstreet Boys, but the buck stops there. Nobody's gonna be proudly reminiscing on 98 Degrees, are they? If you want a really fun time, then you should dig up boy bands like Boyzone, or B4-4, or Dream Street. And of course, after this music went completely and utterly out of style by the early 2000s, there was this grace period, or should I say disgrace period, where everyone could admit that this was all some vapid junk. But everyone was still listening to post-grunge and bling rap at the time, so who really knows? And don't ask me if I'm Team Backstreet or Team NSYNC in the comments, because I do not care! I was born in 1997, so I don't really have a horse in this race, you feel me? My favorite boy band at the time was probably the Wiggles. This stuff all passed me right by. And so if those dark times for music can reshape themselves into something more cheery, that seems to be how things are shaping up right now. Music to pick your chin up to. Pop artists are looking to music of years past for inspiration, as you're not going to find many types of upbeat music in these times. Some artists have been trying to turn the finger-snapping, soda-sippin' style of 1950s doo-wop into modern successes. Which might be a stray point, or maybe not, but people have taken note that borrowing happiness from a bygone era did make them stand out among the current crowd. The actual effectiveness of these as songs is a moot point, since they all at least stood out against contemporaries, even if for all the wrong reasons sometimes. And do you know what other music can really brighten your mood? Dance music. It's kind of a genius move, actually. This shift towards a happier mindset could have manifested in a variety of ways, which, to be fair, it absolutely is, but why are artists using disco in particular? Well, this all goes back to how people actually utilize dance music. For something to crash and burn like disco did, it first had to reach an incredible height. There was never a crunkcore demolition night, for instance. So let's stop and ask ourselves, why did people latch onto disco so much? Simplest explanation, it was dance music being made at a time when audiences were wanting a popular music to dance to. The thudding four-on-the-floor beats made it music that was accessible for everybody, opening the doors for even white audiences to dance along.
For the kind of dancing that white people are used to doing, this clearly defined beat that is so apparent in disco music now makes it easier to learn to do what, our kind of dancing.
Using brick-and-mortar locations for a fun social activity that prioritizes this music is what instilled its popularity. Discotheques had been around for decades before disco came around, though. They originated in France during World War II, many, many years before we had a style of music we called disco. The crux of the biscuit is, if your music is something explicitly made for dancing, that goes a long way and leads to a lot of sales if you market it correctly. If you want an example, you're not going to find much better than using the most successful song in the Billboard Hot 100's history. Chubby Checker's The Twist was the first and only time a song hit number one, fell off the charts entirely, and then was brought all the way back to the number one position a year later. If people can dance to your music, it has a new life to it. Associating an activity to a recorded piece of music gives it an extra degree of usefulness and possible longevity. And look at this, the song that replaced The Twist from the number one spot was a different song called Peppermint Twist. See what I'm getting at here? Now, dance music is all something I can appreciate from a far, far distance, because I can't dance in the slightest. No sense of rhythm here. You've heard the term two left feet? Well, I've got three left feet somehow. A modern-day Kunta Kinte on the dance floor. Okay, scratch that last one. I got carried away. I just hate dancing so much. In my early days as a musician, a switch kind of flipped on for me when I realized that nobody would ask me to dance if I was the one holding a guitar, so I just started to embrace that when I had to. When we're looking at the history of dance music and how it correlates with the record-buying public, there are several ways to go about it. For the dance music conversation, I'm excluding the most literal-minded of the genre. I consider stuff like the cha-cha slide, the macarena, watch me whip Nene, the cupid shuffle, mashed potato time, crank dat soldier boy, the locomotion, and teach me how to dougie as novelties, and I don't think there's a single great song in the bunch. Let's take it way back. American-made music designed for dancing begins all the way back to our country's first significant art form, ragtime. Big band music and swing was tailor-made for dance halls, and for decades, vocal jazz would get couples moving on the dance floors without fail. The song that's considered to be the dividing line between the before and after rock era that we are still living in today was We're Gonna Rock Around the Clock. Famously, it only had modest success when it was first released, and it wasn't until it was used in the opening sequence to the film Blackboard Jungle that it took off, and the response was unbelievable. Literal teenage riots started up in the movie theaters. This new sound forced anybody with an earshot to get up and move around. It's not a far cry to see why the uptight saw it as devil's music. For its beginning years, rock and roll was dance music. The defining element of rock music that makes rock music is its emphasis on the backbeat. That's it. And you better believe that just about all dance music has a heavy backbeat to it. 60s R&B filled this role for a while, but splintered off into different directions, and people didn't have that one uniform music being made for dancing anymore. Until disco came around. Disco's lifespan was pretty short in reality. The genre's first chart topper came in 1974 with either Rock the Boat by the Hughes Corporation or the Love's Theme instrumental by Barry White's Love Unlimited Orchestra, depending on how you personally choose to define disco. The following year, the genre became undeniably tied to dance music when The Hustle became a global phenomenon, which itself took a few pages from Love's Theme. But we're not here to talk about how it started. No, we are here to talk about its crash and burn. Whew. Disco smoke. Don't breathe this. Disco's end, much like its lifestyle, was one set in overindulgence. It didn't take long for audiences to bore of the same tired roster of sounds being featured in its music. Every song had the same whinnying string sections, duct tape snare drums, and consistently high volumes. It was just an exhausting music to always be surrounded by. Listening to enough of these songs in succession, the four-on-the-floor drum beat can be impossibly monotonous and stands in direct contrast to funk's rhythmic innovations. That's not to mention that many just hated disco culture in and of itself. It was inescapable as a cultural juggernaut, and many felt it was almost the complete opposite of rock music. And we all know how headstrong those rock diehards can be. Rock music purists were especially betrayed by the disco takeover. It was a stab in the back to see the unmatched profit margins and blinding ubiquity of disco music consume their own icons, such as the Rolling Stones, Kiss, Queen, Rod Stewart, Pink Floyd, just to name the obvious ones. Even the king of rock and roll himself had been contaminated by this disco infestation. Not to mention everybody's favorite Beatle. What? Oh, whoops. I guess I meant the other one. And of course, this music was a big deviation from rock's succinct 3-minute verse-chorus-verse songs. Disco pioneered the 12-inch single to stretch these songs out and keep people on the dance floors. Disco would be a producer's playground with an affinity for ornate string sections and the ability for instruments to drop in and out at moments' notice, clearly a move away from the self-reliant rock band archetype set up by the Beatles. By the time Saturday Night Fever became a multimedia sensation, there was no going back.
Present the award for the album of the year. And the winner is Saturday Night Fever!
1979 was now a world where the Saturday Night Fever soundtrack was the best-selling album in history. The music wasn't just mainstream, it has overtaken the mainstream. And this fact here may or may not be relevant, but seeing as how disco music and discotheques started out as a safe haven for minorities and featured strong themes of feminism and equality to its music, it is pretty disappointing that the biggest emblem of the disco era features only white men. Of the 17 songs on the soundtrack, only 5 of them didn't come from a white guy. And this was a sore spot for many of disco's original fans, and kind of shows why the ship was capsizing. Newcomers were rocking the boat too much and throwing its members overboard. What once was an exclusive party was now overtaken by drunken dude bros in polyester suits looking to score. Hey hot stuff, who's got 2 thumbs and doesn't care about the social ramifications of ruining disco music for the people that actually need it? This guy! Give me some sugar, baby. Its boom in popularity overcrowded most discotheques, actually barring its original and most devoted followers from entry, favoring the flashier, more attractive personnel. TV had weekly shows about disco dancing. Sesame Street sold disco parody albums. Burger King used disco music to promote their artery cloggers. Every TV show theme song was disco. Ethel Merman was making disco remakes of her Broadway songs. This is getting out of hand. Historians are also lucky that the genre has one singular song to pinpoint the exact moment that this craze went all too far. The boneheaded and unfathomably not funny Disco Duck perfectly demonstrated the artistic bankruptcy of the genre. To make matters worse, Disco Duck was the back-to-back number one song against Walter Murphy's A Fifth of Beethoven. Walter Murphy eventually became the primary music composer to the TV show Family Guy. That's kind of weird, isn't it? 1976 has often been called by music historians the worst year in music history, and disco was just about at its height. Disco has reached its critical mass, and people were all too aware of this. What goes up must come down. July 12th, 1979 is widely accepted to be the death to the disco genre, where Disco Demolition Night was held at Chicago's Comiskey Park. The events that took place in that ballpark that day is the stuff of music legend. Shock jock radio DJ Steve Dahl was hired to pull together a promotion for the White Sox team, who were suffering from a particularly lackluster season. Ticket sales were dwindling, and promoters wanted to get inventive and find new ways to get butts into seats. The gimmick was a good one. Bring in a disco record, and you'll get admission for just 98 cents. What a steal! Disco was the thorn in Steve Dahl's side, as his former radio station was reformatted from his progressive rock lineup to an all-disco, all-the-time format instead, ending in Dahl losing his job at the station. I do not know why or how they made the jump from these two specific genres, but whatever. He'd become something of a local celebrity for his on-air riffing about disco records. His shtick would be to play the opening seconds of a disco song and abruptly rip the needle across the record, destroying it live on air, which would finish with him superimposing a big ol' explosion sound effect, blowing up the disco record live on the radio. This act struck a chord with many disgruntled rock listeners, and the news of his disco demolition night kept many people abuzzin', because people weren't just head over heels about getting discounted baseball tickets by bringing in a disco record. The big draw was that the records would be collected and placed into a box on the field filled with explosives to be detonated at the end of game one. Which is especially funny, because the White Sox had previously held a regular, old-fashioned disco night in 1977. But the publicity stunt worked way better than anybody could have ever anticipated. The White Sox officials were hoping for a turnout of 20,000, about 5,000 better than previous games. Over 50,000 people attended this game instead, including thousands more climbing over the gates to join the party. The stadium received so much vinyl that they stopped accepting the disco records at the door, so the participants would be throwing the records around like frisbees during the game, littering the field. And vinyl makes for a better frisbee than you'd probably imagine. Take it from me. Leading up to the demolition, Dahl rode onto the field in full army general garb and began his crowd-working hype man routine, leading the crowd with chants of, "Say it with me now.
Disco sucks! Disco sucks! Disco sucks!"
Dahl proudly proclaimed to the crowd that they were now taking part in the world's largest anti-disco rally.
This is now officially the world's largest anti-disco rally!
Anybody who was there just for the baseball game was surely at a loss. The death of disco was imminent and nobody had a clue. After drumming it up for long enough, he finally set off the explosives with all of the disco records inside. And it was kind of underwhelming at first. Just a few cherry bombs went off. But it turns out they put way too many explosives in there, and when it blew up, it exploded. Disco record shrapnel was blown sky high, and the explosion charred the baseball field. This was a pressure drop that prompted the crowd to storm the field and run wild, all in the name of their disco hatred. And it was a disaster. By all accounts, a disaster. Fires were set to the field. Fans were shrieking around naked, allegedly. Banners as far as the eye could see all read, "Disco sucks. Death to disco." There was no choice but to completely cancel the second game, as the mob couldn't be controlled and the field was unplayable, forcing the Sox to forfeit. Complete pandemonium ensues. Poor Harry Carey was inconsolable, desperately pleading for the crowd to sit back down in their seats, all for the love of baseball. His idea of crowd control was leading a sing-along to "Take Me Out to the Ball Game," soundtracking the carnage set before him. Security, in an effort to prevent any more intruders from sneaking into the game, padlocked all but one gate, making any escape from this rampage impossible. This was the biggest ballpark disaster since 10 Cent Beer Night. The wreckage was nationally televised and ingrained the message to everybody in America loud and clear. Disco sucks. Death to disco. The disco era has officially ended. At the time of the demolition, the most recent number one songs in the country were by Donna Summer, the Bee Gees, Anita Howard, Donna Summer again, and Chic. And by August, it was My Sharona, cementing new wave as the sought-after sound from here on out and confirming that disco was donezo. That is a fast turnaround. My Sharona was the fastest-selling gold record in Capitol Records history since the Beatles. The rush to replace disco was ridiculous. Disco was America's collective drunken mistake from the night before that made everyone wake up the morning after and wonder, what on earth were we thinking?
Oh.
There would be no more disco by 1980. Of course, it's been well documented that a lot of disco's abrupt downfall and much of the absolute derision brought upon it was one rooted in homophobia and racism. I just don't want to get into the issue myself because the bone has been picked pretty clean by people who are probably much smarter and better with words than I am. Xenophobia was a significant contributor to its downfall, no doubt about it. I did not see many women or people of color in that baseball stadium that day, but I still did want to highlight that a lot of its collapse was from the culture's oversaturation of the music. This is a music discussion channel first and foremost, after all. And even if its intense and sudden death didn't happen, it's not very likely that this genre would have survived into the Reagan presidency anyways. If you wanted more evidence that disco would be impossible by the 80s, then let's check out the sequel to Saturday Night Fever called Staying Alive. No, not Staying Alive, Staying Alive. I want to take a quick look at how this holds up, because it might actually have been— OH MY GOODNESS! Okay, yeah, it's totally a cheap shot to use this as any kind of proof that disco was unfit for the 80s. But having this, as the follow-up to the film that brought disco's popularity into the stratosphere, is still rather indicative.
What I want to do?
What? You know what I want to do?
What?
Strut.
Literally overnight, audiences and record labels alike wouldn't dare touch anything disco with a 10-foot pole. Disco artists, R&B artists, funk artists, and more were all abandoned because anything they released would be forever undercut by the simple saying, disco sucks. If you're anything even quasi-related to disco, it sucks now. Sucks now. Always sucked. Just the suckiest bunch of sucks that ever sucked. It didn't help either that a metric buttload of disco artists were one-hit wonders anyways, who relied on their producers to generate their songs for them. Most of them didn't have an iota of staying power. So the music died overnight, but it also didn't. Nobody would dare call the music they're making disco anymore, I mean, duh. So it instead adapted the moniker of club music for their own safety. And this is where it all gets fun. Disco's death gave way to a new style of music. One that would gestate entirely in the underground, growing like a fungus hidden away from the sunlight, mutating and expanding until it's too massive to ignore any longer and eventually infests everything it contacts. This is the start of post-disco.
An elegant disco for a more civilized age.
I can't find an exact approximation of when music writers began seriously using this term post-disco. A lot of its early uses was for making fun, juxtaposing the term post-disco with other more respectable musics, like post-punk. Using such a distinct and noble classifier on disco music was a joke. When the sound of post-disco began to take form, it was taking these disco tropes that were still perfectly usable as song templates and dressed them up in some 80s tech. It could feel like disco, but the pitchforks would come out if you sounded like disco. Besides just the cultural backlash, a lot of disco's downfall came also from the changing technologies in music. Disco itself was a warped version of funk, meaning both genres championed using actual full flesh and blood bands playing behind them. There wasn't much else as an option at the time, I know, unless you were on the bleeding edge of electronic music with Kraftwerk and company. But it still is worth acknowledging, because there has been so little dance music ever made that doesn't rely on digital band components. That's what I immediately think of when I hear the term dance music. Big synthesizers and drum machines. Post-disco comes from the genre's maturation from the more in-the-know artists before the bubble completely burst, along with explorations with synthesizers and more spacious R&B sounds. Drum machines came into play, and emptiness in the mix was a desired effect. Whereas the disco as we knew it was all about excess, throwing nearly every instrument into the song and having the musicians play on every beat. For all you could say about the fakeness of disco, it was still all composed and recorded with organic instrumentation, but this was going to change in the 1980s post-disco landscape. One could also assume that when the disco industry collapsed, there was less money going into full, lush orchestrations. Disco, like funk, was very bass-heavy, and when you remove some of its external instrumentation, and especially when you swap it out for synth bass, its influence on electronic music becomes crystal clear. Blend some of this stuff with a little Blue Monday, and the last 30 years of music makes a lot more sense now. Using these different, less organic instruments changed the overall mood of these songs, too. Keyboards have always been used to express colder, more sterile emotions, and when coupled with lyrics about dancing, many of these songs take on the themes of dancing in the face of difficult circumstances. A bittersweet idea to underscore its amp-up music. Dancing out of desperation. The previous fallout of disco's past certainly added to these themes as well. This is actually the exact message of Saturday Night Fever that seems to have been lost on many people at the time. Travolta played an absolute loser stuck in a dead-end job whose only escape was going to a dance club one night a week as his own personal salvation. He was not the pinnacle of cool like many saw him as. This sound of post-disco might have also stemmed from when R&B began diverging into the Quiet Storm genre, a muted and more spacious examination of this type of music. The time frames line up too, from the late 70s to the early 80s being the genre's heyday too. The waning days of disco had songs with breakneck tempos sometimes, to the point where you have to ask, how can anybody anywhere ever even dance to this? If people can't dance to your disco music, then why even bother? Except for that one. That one gets a pass. Post-disco, by comparison, uses a more mid-tempo approach, complemented by the change in instruments and lyrics, which gives it a lot more breathing room, especially when compared to some of the claustrophobic 80s dance music. This is an unbelievably good song, by the way. Put this on your playlist if you haven't heard it before. It was during that weird gap period between disco's death and 80s pop successes that some began using these exploratory sounds as their own stepping stone, along with co-opting elements of the burgeoning house scene that was running alongside post-disco. And I'll be the first to admit that I get more than just a little bit lost when I'm talking about electronic music. I really need to get better at it. Like, I couldn't tell you the difference between trance or big beat or something. I do know enough to not just call it all techno, though. Learned that. But then again, techno must be its own kind of music, too, so I really don't know. So I'm going to try my best here when I talk about how post-disco influenced club music and house music, and I know how clueless I must sound to anybody who's actually in the know. I imagine it would sound like if somebody was ignorant of rock music and asked if Lynyrd Skynyrd was a thrash metal band or something. There you go, that's my disclaimer. On with the video. Have you ever noticed how the biggest pop artists of the 80s had narrowly avoided disco's downfall, all while still producing disco-adjacent material? They built on these sounds and adapted them to a new generation, something that likely would have happened in the genre's natural progression if it hadn't flatlined instead. So now that we're up to speed on the sounds of post-disco and the general time frame this all happened in, do you want to know what professionals claim to be the most successful post-disco album of all time? Not really, take a guess. Seriously, guess. Guess what it is. Yeah. It's a cheap pick, but post-disco is also a pretty loose genre term, and Thriller fits the description shockingly well. Otherwise, what genre would you call Thriller besides just 80s R&B? That's not very specific. So there it is, I get to wrangle in the most successful album in the history of recorded music for a genre that nobody's ever heard of and debatably doesn't even exist. This is a good day. But its evolution doesn't just stop here. No siree, it does not. In the final days of the 70s, when disco was dead as dead over here in the States, it gave way to the thriving Italo disco music, which then fed back into house music, keeping the spirit of dance music alive in the clubs and further experimenting with entirely electronic-made music first set up by Giorgio Moroder. Holy smokes, you can make an entire song without using a single natural instrument. This blew the doors wide open, and the entirety of the 80s was jam-packed with musicians experimenting with this big musical revelation. So even after disco was done for, ABBA was still notching out bona fide disco hits from half a world away, obviously undeterred by the cultural backlash from us Yanks across the pond over here. In fact, I think they might have played a very significant part in bringing disco music back in the early 2000s, when they allowed a very rare sampling of their music to Madonna, another post-disco artist, at first at least. ABBA is a group notorious for their refusal of sampling to their music, so this was a big deal for both artists involved. Hung Up was the lead single to Madonna's 10th studio album, Confessions on a Dance Floor. Her hit song, Hung Up, heavily reinterpreted ABBA's Eurodisco favorite, Gimme 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 A Man After Midnight. And this song may have been the catalyst that started jogging people's memories about that once-shunned era of music, and more importantly, how it could relate to current music again. If disco didn't die, house music wouldn't have had its exploration period, and post-disco is the crucial link between them. In fact, some have even taken to calling house music disco's revenge. When talking about the ways house music has grown throughout the years, there is an unmistakable direct connection to music being made right now. Post-disco led the way for house music to become the it scene of the 90s, while still unmistakably being underground. From what I gather, the extremely fervent club scene was always threatening to escape the underground and pull a big takeover onto the mainstream in the 90s, but it never really happened. History could have been very different if Nirvana didn't break right then, at that exact moment, and we instead let the natural course of history continue, allowing every rock band ever to keep ripping off U2's Octomom Baby album, which was what every single band was doing for the first 2 years of the 90s. But grunge happened, and then that was that. Probably for the best. You could assess that this electronica stuff only took hold in the mainstream very, very recently. For anybody who might think rock is dead now, it's mostly because the cross-section of EDM and hip-hop-dependent instrumentals reached their peaks of relevancy around the same time, which basically removed the need for any traditional rock instruments in most music-making today. Cut out the middleman entirely. Them's the facts for now. Making songs entirely out of a MacBook is commonplace. Radio music doesn't need to rely on guitars or acoustic drums for their music anymore, but this was a long time coming. This is the reason why it makes sense for disco to break back through right now. The sticky four-on-the-floor beats of disco made for excellent sampling on a good majority of hip-hop's earliest songs. Early DJs would look for 12-inch disco records with the best breakbeats to play back-to-back, creating a continuous drum loop to dance and MC over. I don't think we've forgotten that Rapper's Delight was built entirely from Chic's late-period disco track, Good Times, which was released only 2 months earlier. The tight beats and electronic underpinnings from post-disco had more to offer to West Coast hip-hop than nearly any other form of music to sample. There isn't any question about hip-hop being the most dominant form of music today, and disco is still firmly rooted into its very foundation.
Birthdays was the worst days, now we sip champagne when we thirsty.
But not that minute, but you're the only love that gives me good
and let's reminisce on when every radio smash from 2007 was all about being in the club! You know, bottles and models music. An era for the pop charts when every song had the same incessant, thumping, oomps, oomps, oomps beat. You couldn't turn your radio on without being clubbed over the head with these songs about partying in the clubs. Music made for and about dance clubs hasn't been popular since disco music for discotheques. This is not a coincidence. This era of popular music was among the first crop to be derived entirely from electronic-based music, specifically EDM, house, and rave music, along with its mingling with hip-hop. These styles of music-making have been growing non-stop, always threatening to become mainstream until this time, and modern music hasn't been the same since. Say what you will about the rise and fall of the Black Eyed Peas. Ugh. It is without doubt that there is no other time in music history that they could have reached the levels of success they did with their electroclash computer-programmed sounds. It's interesting that this braggadocio music, clearly derived from bling and mafioso rap, became the popular sound after the economy crashed. Having every song be about spending money in the club and drinking Cristal on ice shouldn't have had the public appeal it did, but yet, it did. It may have even been a work of collective dissociation from American listeners. Even a song like Sia's Cheap Thrills about partying in the face of brokenness seems like it could only have come after the club boom, using the act of clubbing as a means of escapism, much like Tony Manero did in his disco. Youthful unsuredness comes and goes, and studying their means of mental evasion can be eye-opening about a generation. So it's been established now that so much modern pop music comes from a long lineage of dance music, most likely steering closest to house or EDM. For example, let's examine 2011's We Found Love by Rihanna featuring producer Calvin Harris, which is the song almost uniformly identified across the board as the song that opened the floodgates to EDM absolutely dominating modern music. Pay mind to how this watershed moment for dance pop music bears a striking resemblance with the classic house anthem, Gypsy Woman, She's Homeless from 1991. This electronica takeover was a long time coming, and clearly didn't come from nowhere. The seeds had been planted long ago. And surprisingly enough, it was Justin Bieber of all people who played an undoubtedly large role in EDM becoming the primary force in pop music today. By 2015, his time in the spotlight should have by all means faltered and went away after puberty hit him like a freight train, and his public image was at an all-time low after a several-year stretch of newspaper headline after newspaper headline for all the wrong reasons. But against the odds, he took part in a collaborative effort with Diplo and Skrillex that was absolutely revolutionary for the time. It was groundbreaking for EDM to infiltrate modern pop sensibilities to that capacity, laying down the blueprint for the shape of pop to come in the process, and leaving a chapter of music history that, begrudgingly, places Bieber on the cutting edge of music. And whether you like it or not, his DNA is locked into the song itself. Even that signature keyboard sound that's become iconic at this point came from his own voice being super manipulated.
So it's like pitched way up, distorted, bounced, rebounced again, so it sounds worse almost.
And that's the state of music now. At face value, it's difficult to see the connection from this music to its disco roots, but I hope the through line has been highlighted for you now. A chapter of music history that might not have gotten its time in the spotlight, but thrives regardless. And who knows where the music of tomorrow might take us? There might just be some of the most important music sounds happening right now that we won't know about until much, much later. So keep an open ear or two. Time tells a different story through the years, and the music of the past might lead to a better future today. And the beat goes on. Hey guys, thanks for joining me on this voyage from the dance floors to the streaming age. I hope that you'll walk away from this video with some more appreciation for this music than when you walked in. Please check out my other videos if you get the chance. This is a new channel and all the support helps a lot. And please stick around for my next video, which is going to be a classic song review of In My House by the Mary Jane Girls. You may remember it or you may not, so maybe give it a spin in the meantime. Otherwise, check out my last few videos or the music I make under the Arizonan Summer moniker. The full debut album is available for streaming and purchase right now. Leave a comment below and smash that subscribe button! Again, this is a new channel, so a little support goes a long way. Thank you. And last but not least, remember to keep your eyes to the stars and your ear to the radio. Good night, everybody.